Good evening and welcome to the October 12th, 2016 Board of Education meeting for Queen Anne's County. At this time, could I get a motion to go into closed session?
So moved.
As permitted by the Section 3-305B of the General Provision Article of Annotated Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session to discuss the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, promotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluations or appointees, employees, or officials over whom this public body has jurisdiction, or any other personal matter that affects one or more specific individuals, to consult with the staff, consultants, or other individuals about pending or potential legislations, and the conduct, collective bargaining, negotiations, or consider matters that relate to negotiations, to review the HR report, transportation report, and the meeting minutes from September 7th and from the 21st.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Do I have any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. We will return at 6 p.m.
Welcome to the Board of Education's meeting. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for the county citizens to review on QACTV7, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table, and during this meeting, we would ask that you would turn off your pagers and or cell phones and leave conversations at a minimum comment outside of the meeting room. Thank you so much.
Pledge of Allegiance.
Now we'll be led by the Pledge of Allegiance by our President, Jennifer George.
Thank you, Arlene.
You're welcome.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the October 12th Board of Education meeting. At this time, I need an approval to approve the agenda. I need a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
So moved.
I have a motion. I have a second.
Second.
Any questions or comments regarding the motion?
I move that we amend the agenda to move 7.05 collective bargaining agreement signing to be the first item under individual action right above 7.01, the BTE master plan. In addition, add 7.09 approval of the Board of Ed collective bargaining teams.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to amend the agenda item 7.05, moving it above 7.01, the collective bargaining agreement, and to add 7.09 to approve the collective bargaining teams. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Next, I need a motion to approve the minutes from September 7th and September 21st, open and closed session.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the approval of minutes from September 7th and September 21st. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. At this time, we will move on to recognitions. And the first one is the special recognition.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Tonight we'd like to express our appreciation and thanks for the efforts of our talented staff. The Queen Anne's County Public Schools Energizer Bunny Award is given to an employee or volunteer who just keeps going. Their energy is endless and their hard work always shines through. This award is sponsored by our long-term partnerships, Mr. Chip Brittingham, Mr. Wayne Humphreys, and Mr. Mark Humphreys at Bayview Financial. This month, Southersville Elementary School Principal Kim Seidel, as well as her entire staff, have nominated Ms. Michelle McNeil as their month's Energizer Bunny. This is the first time we have received two nominations in the same month for one person. Would Michelle please come forward? According to Ms. Seidel and her staff, Michelle plays an integral role in their school. Michelle is the teacher specialist at Southersville Elementary School, and during Ms. Seidel's transition summer into becoming the new principal at Southersville Elementary School, Michelle was a huge help. She has gone above and beyond her teacher specialist duties to always be on top of things and support everyone at Southersville Elementary School. She is respected by all and has shown everyone what teamwork is all about. Michelle is a rock star, and her love of teaching and learning shows every day. It's true. Actually, Ms. Seidel often refers to Michelle as her chief of staff. Teachers like Michelle are preparing and making a difference for our schools, our children, our communities, and most of all, our future. Michelle, thank you on behalf of the Board of Education. Congratulations. Ms. Seidel, please come up and join us. Congratulations. Stand right in the center.
One, two, three.
We now have another Energizer Bunny of the Month and another rock star. Would Susan Davis, our coordinator of our ESOP program, please come forward?
I'm bringing the bunny with me.
Gotcha. Who is our coordinator of our ESOP program has nominated someone very important to the ESOP team, and that is Ms. Gina Morris, who is also a rock star. Gina is a parent liaison for all of our schools in Centerville, Graysonville, and Kent Island. She works closely with our non-English speaking families to provide support with registration, updating back to school forms, and general communication between the home and the school. Families feel comfortable with Gina and greatly appreciate her advocacy. Gina works with families in the morning, in the afternoon, and at night to meet their everyday needs. We are beyond fortunate to have her dedication, her skills, and her energy in Queen Anne's County. Thank you on behalf of the Board of Education for making the difference. And last, we have a very special recognition this evening. Dr. Elaine O'Neill, our supervisor of curriculum instruction for elementary education, has nominated a group of ladies who work with the early childhood programs at Southersville Elementary School who are making a difference, and the Maryland State Department of Education has taken notice. May Lauren Dean please come forward? Tracy Breeze, please come forward. Christina Landgraf, please come forward. Mary Alice Munson, please come forward. Elizabeth Miller, please come forward. Barbara Thurber, please come forward. Duana Alvarez, please come forward. Michelle McNeil, please come forward. Rebecca Van Aken, please come forward. Carrie Kane, please come forward. Lori Yarborough, and Sherry Brooks. Please come forward. This team of talented Queen Anne's County Public Schools rock stars are being recognized for their work at the Judy Center Partnership and our pre-K program at Southersville Elementary School. The Southersville Elementary School Judy Center Partnership has achieved MSDE accreditation this past summer. This is a process that early childhood programs go through every 3 years, which demonstrates the commitment to continuous quality improvement to benefit children, family, and their staff. It is a program required of schools who house a Judy Center, which is pursuing self-appraisal, program improvement, and external program review to confirm that they have met state, regional, and national standards. Congratulations, Judy Center, on your accomplishments and your state accreditation. Also, the Southersville Elementary School pre-K went through the Maryland Excels process. This is a quality rating improvement system that awards a rating from 1 to 5, 5 being the highest, based on recognized standards of best practice. Southersville Elementary School pre-K achieved a 5, the highest level that you could achieve, and was the second pre-K program in the state of Maryland to go through this entire rigorous process. Ladies, congratulations. Thank you for all your dedication to the children of Southersville area, your dedication every day, your passion for children, and your commitment to close that achievement gap by the end of grade 2, and like yourself, your role models for others. On behalf of the Board of Education, thank you for what you do every day and making a difference in the lives of students, parents, and the community. Thank you. You gotta join your team.
With the tall people.
Ready? 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Thank you.
Got real shoes on me.
When isn't it not killing me?
I can barely step down on it.
I'm wearing them boots.
I'm not gonna stop wearing my shoes.
Participation. Does anybody have
it? There's everybody going.
They're running.
Out they go.
I'll give you a call.
The sign in sheet for you. I'll wait till everybody
got it.
Clean up.
Is there anybody on
no.
there? Okay. No. Nobody on there.
Nobody on there.
So at this time in the evening, it is the citizen participation public comment. If there's nobody on the written list, if anybody would like to come up and speak, this would be the time. Okay. Doesn't look like it. So we'll move on to the student member of the board reports. Anam, I believe Paige went first last time, correct? So we'll give it back to you. I'll keep it fair.
I can go first. So for student government updates, we don't have much. We do have a reflection on what happened for homecoming. So the homecoming dance went pretty great. It was an overall success. Our pep rally and football game were moved to Monday because of the storm and why I couldn't make it to our school. And we won 45-8. Pretty bad. And in November, we have an upcoming blood drive. We do not have a set date yet, but we are starting preparations for that. And then for overall school updates, October 6th, we had our financial aid night. That's when a representative from Chesapeake College came in and spoke to parents and students about financial scholarships, how to do FAFSA, and other financial aspects of the college applications. This week is actually college application week. It's October 11th to October 18th, and this is when, like, the guidance department's going to be doing a bunch of things, like Yesterday, they set up the hallways and the lunch tables with different information about colleges. And then at the end of the week, we're going to be having a college fair with different colleges that are around in the area. And then PSATs is October 19th, the PSATs for sophomores and juniors. It will be the day for seniors to work on their applications. Last week of October are midterms. November 5th is our Barnes & Noble night, which is being done by Interact Club and Book Club. And we're going to we're getting volunteers from around the school, and we're going to be doing an event at the Barnes & Noble in Annapolis. And it's going to be cool. It's going to have like a STEM table, and we're going to be helping the customers, and the school's getting a good percentage of it. And then we have a random act of kindness that Mr. Schreck told me about was the football, girls basketball, and cheerleaders raised $1,300 for the grandson of the Stephen Decatur coach, which was really sweet. And Ms. Harper let me know that the varsity girls soccer won the title of North Bayside last year. Last night. Sorry, I'm a little sick. And we have an upcoming game with Snow Hill.
Next week.
That's all for me today.
Thank you, Anand.
It's my pleasure.
I believe Ms. Harper let me know you have a special evening planned. So if you would like to be dismissed, you may. That would be fine.
Yes. My mom's coming home from Pakistan. She's been gone for a month and a half.
Hit the road.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Have a very good night.
Thank you.
And Paige.
Well, this week is our homecoming week. And our spirit week this week, Monday was USA Day, yesterday was Mismatch Day, today was Costume Day, tomorrow is Class Color Day, and then Friday is Green and Gold Day. It's also our pep rally. It's also Powder Puff Game after, if you want to come watch that. It'll be interesting, I promise. And then Saturday we have our homecoming parade at 10, and then our homecoming football game, when we reverse Stephen Decatur, is at 1. And then we have our homecoming dance is at 7. And our theme this year is, it's a circus theme, but the title of it's called Cirque Day QA.
Oh, cute.
And this is also our college application process month, pretty much. We have a bunch of financial aid nights, a lot of college visits coming, and then we have a lot of nights that are giving help with applications because everyone's getting in by November. Scary. And then the first week of November is our fall play. And then with sports, last month was Childhood Cancer Awareness Month, and a lot of our sports teams were doing donations and stuff for that. So if you could wear gold to any of the games, and then you know donate money for the childhood awareness, and then you can buy T-shirts and headbands and support. And then I know the volleyball team did this. They brought out cancer patients at the beginning of the game, so it was the little kids, and it was really cute. And we did a really good job. And then varsity volleyball beat Kent Island for the first time in 6 years. Sorry.
Sorry. It was a lucky chance.
Big deal. No, that's a big deal.
That's about it.
Great. Thank you.
I think Chesapeake College is also, on the thing of the college fair, Chesapeake College is holding a forum where they invite colleges to come in and present stuff to students. Broadneck holds one, and then Chesapeake College holds one, and they're always in the month of October. It's very interesting to go see, you know, to see other colleges from around the country actually attend this.
Thank you, Paige. Next on the agenda are the presentations. First one is the financial audit report.
Our auditors are not yet here. I had told them 6:30, so... they're not here yet, so if we want to jump over them and coach
the
next
we'll skip that.
Okay.
We'll move on to the pre-K-12 enrollment report by grade level with Mr. Engel. Good evening. Do we need a minute?
Yeah. Thank you, Robin. Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the 2016-17 school year. This is the enrollment data report. And just to give you guys an idea, take a look at some data. This chart gives sort of the big picture of where we are with enrollment. Our enrollment numbers for our September 30th count is 7,757. And you can see the numbers are organized by grade and by school. And I'm, in some of the other slides, I'll show a breakdown of kind of where we're going. I think one thing that's interesting is that this piece of information, we really haven't, there's not a whole lot of variance over the last 10 years as far as our enrollment. You know, maybe a 1% variance either way, plus or minus. You can see the numbers have remained pretty constant over the past 10 years. And we got this information from the State Department of Education. You know, in comparison to some of the other counties, which is not here, some of the other larger counties have had huge influxes of students and as many as 6 to 10% increases in enrollment. We have managed to stay about the same. I found that interesting. This is a breakdown of our ethnicity, and you can see it's it shows you know, our numbers last year as compared to this year, and hasn't been, you know, too much variance in that either. If we look at our elementary schools, the blue numbers on the left are our enrollment for this year, September 30th, 2016, and as compared to last year. And again, not a lot has changed. We still have our largest elementary schools in Centerville, with Centerville Elementary and Kennard, and you can see our smaller schools, Churchill and Sudlersville. As we saw tonight, though, numbers don't mean a thing. There's a lot of strength in some of these smaller schools, for sure. So you can see that the numbers are there, and they've remained about the same. There have been some increases and decreases. Looking at the middle school numbers, again, you have the Centerville Middle as the largest number. Mattapique had a bit of a drop, as you can see.
And also because that ninth grade went upstairs, the eighth grade went upstairs to the ninth grade.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was the biggest grade.
So larger.
Yeah, that was a larger grade, so that's that. Then you look at the high school, and you can see that the numbers where Mattapique lost were gained at Kent Island High School. And thought we'd add this in, and you can see the numbers of students that are on home instruction. We have 173 that are under an approved umbrella. Either they're taking Griggs or Keystone or some other home instruction unit that we don't monitor. We monitor 108 students. They come in twice a year, and Gene Cardwell oversees that. And then we have students, we have five students that are 17, and so we don't monitor those students. Once they turn 17, we stop monitoring them. A couple things. Also, last year, we had over 100 students on home hospital. For various reasons, I thought, even though they're assigned to a school, I thought that was worth noting, that those numbers have increased over the past few years, and we've had a number of students that have been out for various reasons. And another category that's, again, these students are assigned to schools, we have 63 students that are identified as homeless last school year. All of them were in sheltered homes. Probably two-thirds of the students were doubling up, and probably about a third of them were in transitional housing, meaning that they had lost their home of origin and they were living in a temporary place. So I thought those things were worth mentioning. So that's our enrollment. Any questions?
Do you have any questions?
No. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
Engel. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Engel.
Next on the agenda for presentations, we have the school safety and security presentation.
The auditors are here.
Oh, they are? Mm-hmm. They're, okay. We can go back to the auditors. Okay, we'll jump back for a second, and we will have the presentation of the financial audit report. Thank you, Raman. Oh, I guess I need to move on. Oops.
I don't know how you want to do this.
They have actually have the electronic copy.
Oh, okay.
So let them go with that for now.
No problem.
If they want paper copies, then we have that available.
So we have with us tonight, this is Joanne Crowder with Mayor Hoffman and McCann. She is the principal shareholder partner.
Shareholder partner.
And basically oversees our audit each year. Terry Overton is the senior auditor who took care of us this year. But I'm going to turn it over to Joanne and let her walk you through the financial statements and tell you how we did.
Thank you very much. Good evening.
Before she gets started, would you like a paper copy of the statements to look at as she's going through it?
Is it on our board docs?
It is the electronic
copy. I may reference page number. It'll be the actual page number.
I need one of my computers now.
So is mine.
I'll try. I'm not going to go through every page.
So is hers.
Yeah, mine's taking some time, but it's loading. It's just slow.
Oh, it just came up.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's loading very slow.
Mine just came up.
For some reason.
Thank you.
Thank you, dear. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here this evening. I'm happy to report the financial audit was completed and timely filed with the State Department of Education as of September 30. There is a second compliance audit where we do the testing of the federal grant programs. That audit report is not due till end of December. We try to get it completed in November. We've done some testing, so those reports will follow later. Internal control, we have no findings to report. There was no deficiencies, no material weaknesses that we felt needed to be put in the report or even issued in some kind of secondary letter. It is what we call a clean opinion, unmodified opinion on the financial statements. Just to give you an overview of what makes up this whole package, you have the audit reports. There's two. One that basically says there's the clean opinion on the statements. Then there's a report on internal control, which says we don't have any findings to report. There's a management's discussion and analysis, which is written by Robin, that hits certain highlights during the year. And then, as I kind of say, you almost have like three sets of financial statements in here. You have one set of financial statements, which is your budget and the actual, which will hit the highlights tonight. You have another set that we call the fund financial statements. And I'm not giving you page numbers just because I don't want you to have to rummage through. The difference between those is how open purchase orders are handled at the end. And then we have what we call the government-wide. The government-wide brings in the cost, the undepreciated cost of your physical property and equipment. It also brings in the long-term liabilities, like an allocation of the state pension liability, the unpaid retirees' health insurance. So it's more on the same level as a commercial enterprise, whereas your other statements only deal with looking for a year. It doesn't include those long-term liabilities. Then there's a small statement with the agency funds, which is the special education?
ESMAC. Easter Shore.
And the school activities funds, then their explanatory notes, and then supplemental schedules in the back. You also received a two or three page letter, which I call this audit summary review letter, that basically hits certain highlights to say we did not have any issues with management. We did have some uncorrected adjustments, but they were minor. It was no major impact on the statements. It gives some of the important estimates and sensitive disclosures. So to go to your thicker package, which is the fund financial statements, if you go to page 14, and this is the statement of net position. This is the statement that I was talking about that is government-wide. It brings in the undepreciated property, plant, and equipment. It also brings in your long-term liabilities. And what I wanted to point out here is when you bring all this in, You have a net investment in your capital assets of $168 million. At the bottom of page 14, you'll see a section called net position. And there's a line, net investment of capital assets of $168 million. Then there's some fund balance for foods that is restricted for food service and capital projects. Then you'll see there's an unrestricted deficit of $47.8 million. This is because of those long-term liabilities I was talking about. This is, what is making this up is the future liability that's determined by an actuary for the, what we call the OPEB, which is the retirees' health insurance. What they do is they actuarially determine the future liability of those personnel working for you now as to what you would have to pay in the future for that. And that liability is currently sitting at about $46 million. Then there's also, we have to pick up a portion of the Maryland State Retirement System unfunded pension liability. And this is for the employees section. It's not for the teachers because the state will cover that. But the part that you have to cover would be for the employees system. And that is about $4.5 million additional liability. This also includes the long-term portion of the capital leases for Johnson Controls and some laptops, and that total is about $2.7 million. And there's also $999,000 of accrued leave that could be paid in the future. Now, some of that went down with the change in the superintendents because that was paid off. So that's actually gone down some.
This is all broken out for you on page 42 under financial statement, the note to the financial statement, number 9, long-term liabilities. It breaks all it breaks down all of those long-term liabilities.
And what you'll see on that page, it gives you the total balance, which is what I was just going through with you. And then there's another column to the right called amounts due within 1 year. So for fiscal year 2017, the estimated liability that would be paid for the accrued leave, which is also called compensated absences, is $370,000. Then there were some retirement incentives from a few years ago with an early retirement package that was done. There was $3,000 expected to be paid out in the new year. Then capital leases in fiscal year 17, you'll pay approximately $334,000. Now, there's no current portion for that OPEB benefit obligation, which is the retirees' health insurance, or the net pension liability of the state. Those items are basically being funded and paid on each year's budgeted expenditures.
Should we be worried about that OPEB?
All governments are worried about it.
Yeah.
This came about, I guess it's been about 5 to 7 years ago. It used to never be reported on the statements. And just to give you a little background as to how it came about, and it's also happened in the commercial world, where there was a lot of, rather than paying people up front early, they were promising better benefits, especially upon retirement, to attract people. So it was, you know, we can keep our cash down now, thinking it's all going to be able to fund itself as you go along. Well, in the accounting world and the actuarial world said, you know, you really have this liability building up that is assuming going to have to be paid at some point. So as I said, right now, it's all that's happening is the amount is being budgeted for the amount that has to be paid each year. Everybody's grappling with it. And a lot of places, there have been a lot of governments and businesses that have changed what they offer new hires. And then they've looked at their benefit packages. So it's there. I don't have any magic answers for it.
So how are we preparing for it?
Well, with the retirees' health insurance, there has been a trust fund set up. It doesn't show up in your accounts here because it was set up by the county. About how many years ago was that? Do you remember?
It's been a while.
It was about five, but right now there's only about $500,000 sitting in that trust fund, a little bit over that. The total amount is actually reported on the county's financial statements, and then they break out how much is allocated because it is Queen Anne's County, Queen Anne's County School Board, Kent County. Is it just, and the Kent County Library? It's three or four entities.
It's Queen Anne's County Library.
Queen Anne's County Library.
So there's four entities. Kent County joined.
Not the school board.
Right, it's just the trust that holds the money for this OPEB liability. And the county is funding part of theirs. They have a 10-year plan to fund their liability, but they have not done anything to fund our liability.
Right.
And we can't put it into our P&amp;Ls for the, I mean, our budget? Can we start stockpiling? I mean, we have to address this.
We could.
We just haven't been able to.
Right, I mean, generally, whatever monies we get, we're using for the current year to fund positions or fund salaries or benefits for our current employees. So we haven't had the luxury of being able to really set anything aside for this.
And I don't know if it's something that they would allow you to, you know, if there's some fund balance left over at the end of the year, part of that, because some of that's now being used to pay for certain types of, you know, what ongoing, like parking lots and.
Mid-sized maintenance projects is what we've been using our fund balance for.
So whether you can, you know, depending on your needs there, and if you can carve out some of this and use that to fund it with money that's left over after a year, that's one area to look.
So county's got $500,000 earmarked for us of this, of our $42 million?
Yes.
Basically, okay. Is it their obligation or our obligation?
That's a question.
I guess they would say it's the board's obligation, but the funding comes from the county.
Right, I mean, they're our funding source, so.
We've never funded this all along?
No.
No.
Okay, so it's never been funded?
Only that initial $500,000, and then whatever earnings have been on top of that. No money has been taken out of it for any of this.
This isn't unusual. All the counties and the state itself has not.
Right.
Correct.
Everybody's in the same position.
Correct.
Because it is a very large liability, and trying to fund it, fully fund it in any given year would be practically impossible.
Are the commissioners aware of, in that government body, of that?
Yes.
This?
Yes.
That's been an ongoing conversation that we've had.
Yes.
Yes, and they have the same thing on their financial statements. They have to pick up their unfunded, you know, retirees' benefits and any unfunded pension liability. So that's on their statements as well.
But you said they're budgeting for that over a 10-year period.
They had set up a plan to fund it over a 10-year period. Now, whether they've actually been able to fund the plan or not, I'm not sure.
I can see the page in their CAFR from last year.
Yeah, I think that they have.
You want to look for it?
Yes.
Okay.
I think that they have been making some headway into funding their liability.
Are we allowed to, though? I mean, seeing that we don't have our own funding source, are we allowed to? Or are we relying on the fund balance? I mean, I'm just asking, I mean, we know this, it's like a preemptive strike, we should be.
We could certainly.
It comes up as part of the budgeting process, you know, whether or not the county would allow you to budget with your current year expenditures a certain amount to go there, or if, like we said, if there's unused fund balance to use that, you know, rather than using some unused fund balance to balance next year's budget, can you say, okay, if we have this amount left over, then we want to put this is the amount we want to put into the trust fund, can we add to it?
And each year, they do fund, we have a line item in our budget that says retiree insurances. So they fund the current year's cost of those benefits to the employee, and they've done that year after year.
It's not that that whole $46 million is going to come due all at one time. It, you know, as new people come into the calculation, some people come out of the calculation, so that's why the funding is really technically been based on what the current year's expenditures have been.
Right, and it's a fluid number. I mean, as your population changes, the number of employees change, it's done as an actuarial calculation, and it's a fluid number.
And as people live longer, then it also helps to increase this actuarial liability.
Right.
And there have been places that have rewritten their benefit packages because of it. Some have gone to more of a, with a defined contribution where they say, okay, we will just contribute this much. We're not going to say it's based on what the premium amount is. So there's various things to consider there.
Thank you.
If you go to page 48, this is the final budget and actual comparison. And as you'll see, we do show the original budget and then the final budget. The only change was in expenditures. The revenue stayed the same for the budget. And then we have a column for the actual and then the variance. And you'll see there's a large variance in the restricted federal, state, and other programs. These are the grant programs from the federal government and the state government, things like Title I, special education. What else is in there?
Title I, Title II, and actually career. If you hate to make you jump back and forth, but if you flip back to page 6 in the financial statement, there's a third bullet there.
Yes.
That explains why that's there was a difference in the restricted funds and basically the special ed pass through discretionary grant wasn't awarded, the targeted one approaching target grant wasn't awarded. Grants such as 21st Century and Title II had less carryover, and then grants such as Special Ed Priority Flexibility, Title I, Title I Migrant, and a couple others had activities planned for July and August, so the money didn't get spent before June. It was spent in July and August. So that gives you some explanation as to why there was such a variance in the grant.
So it can have to do with the programs that actually do come through, and then those that will straddle your year end. They may not end until September, so there might be expenditures. The whole grant might be budgeted in FY16, but there may very well be expenditures in FY17 because of when they actually awarded the grant period. So that's normal.
Yeah, and actually a lot of the special ed and the Title I grants, which are our largest grants, they actually span a two-year period, generally, so.
And then there was significant savings that were able to be realized in the expenditures areas. The largest ones being with special education, student transportation, other instructional costs, and mid-level administration. I don't know if you want to speak to what any of those.
Right. And essentially, these were things that we talked about during the course of the year last year. Under mid-level administration, the largest variance there was where we had replaced personnel, so it was due to attrition. Other instructional costs, and that's our whole instructional program. There was actually, again, attrition was the biggest piece of that. Under special education, we had fewer non-public placement students than what we had had in the past. And if you remember, we actually reduced that line item in the budget for the current fiscal year because of that, which actually is going to turn out to be a problem. But we'll talk about that later. And then in student transportation, because the fuel costs last year were so great, we were actually able to, we didn't have the fuel escalation clause for the bus contractors kick in. We actually were able to withhold money from them because fuel costs were so low. So that's where our variances were.
And then with the adjusted budget at the end of the year, there was $30,000 of fund balance that was believed was going to be needed to cover expenditures. But in the end, because, as she said, with the savings and the fuel costs and these other areas, it was not necessary to use that fund balance.
Right, and that was the $30,000 that we had asked the county for to fund the MABE superintendent search.
Those were the main statements I wanted to review with you. I'm happy to review anything else or answer any other questions in this package.
I have a question.
Yes.
Is it anywhere in, when I was looking through it, I didn't see it, and maybe I missed it, where kind of like a benefit analysis, so to speak, like to see if we're spending our money wisely on programs, and is any part of that in this audit?
No.
It's not.
As far as determining whether it's wisely spent,
yeah,
that's not the focus of the audit we do at this time.
Okay.
When we do the compliance audit, now, it's not looking at whether it's been spent wisely. It's looking to make sure that the money that federal programs we test, the money is being spent within the guidelines of that grant program.
Okay. And another thing is, I had received a letter about a legislative audit that is coming up. And is this the same as that? I mean,
that's
is
on
two
top
different
of
things?
This. That's on top of this. That goes back, when kicked that one up?
12 years ago.
Yes.
Or so. PG County and Baltimore
that's
City both had deficits in their current operating budget. And the state of Maryland at that time was giving us a lot of money through the Bridge to Excellence program. So the legislature decided that they felt they needed a little more oversight on what the local boards of education were doing with the money that they were funding for education. So they introduced a program, legislative auditors, where they went out, they hired a bunch of auditors, and they send them out to the counties, and about every 6 years, they come to visit us, and they do certain programs, and they're very selective depending on, you know, what the political climate is as to what they look at.
They also used to look at policies and procedures to see if you were following those in
so
more
detail. They tell us what they're going to look at. We don't.
Right.
Correct.
Exactly.
Shame they don't look at all the unfunded mandates they stick on the boards of education and see how well we're doing with those.
Right.
But
and
you know,
one
there.
Of the things that they typically look at is transportation.
Okay.
And it's kind of ironic because in all of the counties that do contract out their transportation, mm-hmm. they ask us, have we ever done a cost analysis to bring it inside? And every county that has it inside, they ask them if they've done a cost analysis to contract it.
Right.
So, you know, they're looking at both sides. And if you go out to the legislative auditor's website, all of the audit reports are out there that have been issued in the last 12 years. The last time we were audited was in 2010, so.
Yeah, that's what I think that it said. That's coming soon
that
then?
Should be coming, okay. I would think, probably in the next year.
January.
We will probably hear from them. And generally what they do is they call you and say, we're going to be there next week, and
wow.
when mm-hmm. they come, they are here for months.
Yes.
Months.
The focus of our audit is to determine whether your annual financial statements are fairly stated.
Okay.
And did we find any issues in internal control? Our audit is not focused to be a performance type audit. That's
okay.
almost more of what the legislative auditors are doing.
Okay.
Well, although it's not a complete performance audit, they might go more in that direction.
Right.
But the
and
legislative audit would do more of the cost, I think you mentioned the word effectiveness or a wisely.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Looking at the effectiveness, even though that it's in that category. And so in this audit, it's the internal control that, yes, you're allocating it towards that, but it's the effectiveness or the efficiency of how we're spending that, or
that part of their
is
focus. That might it's probably part
that
of their
is
focus.
Part of their focus. But like I say, they pick and choose certain programs that they want to look at, so it's not a broad-reaching performance audit.
But an audit like that, like a benefit analysis type audit, would benefit us with helping, maybe with this audit, knowing, maybe where the money we're spending is in the right, like, say we had a program and we wanted to see if we're really getting our money's worth out of it, and then we could drop it, so that would kind of show us where in our budget.
Right.
So about a program
really
audit?
We need to do.
Like looking at what we're spending our money on and making sure that the results we're getting is worth what we're putting into it.
We talked about doing
a cost-benefit analysis.
Yeah.
That's in standard five of the curriculum management audit that draws a lot of attention to the cost-benefit analysis of.
Right.
Like when they looked at reading interventions, what are the interventions that we have,
yeah.
which is what we're beginning to look at. How much do they cost? Are they effective? You know,
right.
are they working for students? And if they're not, how do we reallocate maybe some of those resources? And some of that's in program analysis, but I don't think the legislative audit's not going to get to.
No, they don't look at the curriculum side at all.
Okay.
Right.
That's all
I
was curious about.
It's in the
that's getting more into a curriculum side compared to where we're more of just a financial focus.
Great, thank you.
I did have another question. So in our athletic program, such as gate receipts, so where would that revenue show up?
Gate receipts, if it's not on one single line item.
Okay.
It's, if you go to page 8, go ahead.
Actually, on page 54.
Oh, okay, it's got the better breakdown.
It's got a good breakdown, school by school.
Oh, by school.
And you can see exactly what receipts were collected in each of the schools and then what expenditures they had.
Yeah, but that's a generalized receipt, not just about.
Right.
Is this an audit of each one of the schools?
Pardon me?
Is this an audit of each one of the schools?
No, this is just they didn't actually audit these.
Okay.
This is just a statement that we received from the schools saying, you know, this is what we received in gate receipts. This is something my office looks at.
Yes, her office does detailed checking on that during the year, and then we do an overview on top of that at the end of the year to see if anything jumps out at us that might need to be further questioned. But the schools themselves within their accounting records could give you more detail as to where this money came in and was spent. But that's the money that's actually going into and out of those individual school accounts.
Do we ever audit the schools? I mean, that's a lot of money.
It is a lot of money.
I would have to refer Robin if
we actually even
if it's like
that,
an internal audit.
She's doing that. You're doing it.
Yes, we're going out and looking at, you know, what their cash receipts are, what they're dispersing their money on. Obviously, we're not there on a day-to-day basis to make sure that every, you know, nickel and dime is deposited. We have to rely on our school secretaries, our school finance folks to take care of that and to do that for us. But this is like, you know, all the money that comes in for field trips or clubs or yearbooks or
pictures.
Any, you know, pictures, all that stuff is what goes
through. Ads for all the programs.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, it's just over $500,000. It's a lot of money.
Mm-hmm. Your finance department here, which is overseen by Robin, is overseeing all the schools and checking on those accounts during the year, rather than simply relying on us to come in and do a detailed cash audit at the end of the year, which I think probably keeps the schools more accountable, knowing that they're being looked at all year long.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Well, I have a question. My question is like things that we do, like leasing, running the schools out, donations to the school. Where do we find that? Like, I had like Dancing for the Future, that money. Where do we find that money at?
We do not separately state those individual items.
Where would we find them? Because that's an income.
Donation. In this statement, where it is included is on page 18. It's lumped in under other sources, under revenue. We don't do a detailed schedule of that.
That's a lot of money.
We don't.
So generally, $155,000 is donated to the school system in some capacity, if that's what I'm reading correctly. Other sources.
Is there a line item anywhere that
interest
says
where that money? Interest on bank accounts.
Rental of school facilities.
Okay.
Rental of buses, sale of any equipment that we might have.
Mm-hmm. But we don't keep line items of those?
How about the Big Blue?
I do,
she has that in her detail records.
I have all that detail information.
Yes.
Robin, the Big Blue from Stevensville Middle School, would that go under here too?
Actually, that was back in the capital
fund,
so that would not come on the operating budget. Okay. And what you talked about, like Dancing for the Future, that actually is part of the restricted, because it's restricted as to what the use of that money can be. So we account for that as a restricted program as opposed to part of the general unrestricted operating budget.
Is that under the restricted federal
restricted federal state and other.
Okay.
In the 5.6 million that's there?
Right.
One more question.
Okay.
I'm looking under the food service, and I'm looking under expenditures. Can you tell me what that contracted services is?
Sodexo, the contract with Sodexo.
So we pay them $2 million, and we're $26,000 in the hole?
No.
No, we're $26,000.
Over.
So good.
Okay.
Guess what? Should have said excess. 2.4. I apologize. That should say excess of revenues over expenditures.
Are you looking on page?
Page 53.
53? Are you looking at page?
Yeah, I'm looking at page 53. That's what I was looking at, yeah.
Yes, that's actually excess revenues over expenditures.
It's a positive number.
Yes.
It's not bracketed.
And that, I mean, basically, it shows us contracted services, but that accounts for all of the food that they purchase, all of their labor, I mean, that, everything is.
Well, we have salaries and wages in that. I mean, that's separate, that's broke down.
Right, well, we have salaries and wages. We pay part of a maintenance person out of our food service fund to help maintain the equipment. And that is our cost. That $26,000 is half of a maintenance person to help maintain the food service equipment. The $2 million contracted services, that's what we pay Sodexo.
And then they would pay the cafeteria workers?
Right.
And purchase the food from that money?
Right. And then, as you go down farther, we own all of the equipment.
Right.
And we have to maintain all of the equipment.
Right.
So that's what those other expenses are.
Right.
And then supplies, principally U.S. donated commodities. And if you look up at the top portion there, $162,000 in U.S. donated commodities, that's also repeated at the bottom. So out of that $183,000, $162,000 of it is U.S. donated commodities.
Okay.
Okay. Other questions?
Very good. Any other questions, ladies?
Okay, well, I want to draw your attention to one other thing, and that is on page 44, which is basically just a breakdown so that you can see what our fund balances look like and what we have money obligated for. And we have money obligated for our long-term accruals. We have money obligated for future insurance. Our encumbrances, which are would be purchase orders that would have been open at the end of the fiscal year. I'm not sure if this board was here when we offered the retirement incentive a couple years ago where people could take for leaving early. There was a percentage that they got, and they could apply it towards their health care. This is still, we have a few folks that are left that are still applying.
It was 2011, wasn't it? 2010, 2011?
I'm not sure. Something like that, yeah. So we've got a few folks that are still doing that. So that's what that breakdown is. And then down there at the bottom, you can see the unassigned pieces of our fund balance, which is generally the money that we've got an agreement with the county government that we've been allowed to ask to fund some of those mid-size maintenance projects that are too large to be in our operating budget, but too small to be a single maintenance project. So, and generally we do that after the heating season to make sure that we get through the winter, you know, without any problem. And then generally in the spring, we ask for those monies to be transferred over to capital to do those maintenance projects.
Okay.
Any questions?
No, I'm good.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're certainly welcome.
We'll be in touch.
Next on our agenda is the school safety and security presentation with Mr. Pinder.
And Mr. Pinder is going to be joined. I know he'll do the introductions, but our great partnership with our local law enforcement and our emergency response folks.
Good evening. Hi, Mr. Paluski asked me to put together a presentation dealing with our school safety and security. Some of the things that we've implemented, some of the procedures that we've implemented, but basically where we were about 4 years ago and where we are today. I did want to introduce a few people that have been very helpful and are very great communicating with us and working with us. From Centerville PD, we have Lieutenant Meal. We also have Lieutenant Rhodes from Centerville PD. We have Sergeant Hampton from Queen Anne's County Sheriff's Department. We have Lieutenant McDonald, who's the Centerville Barrack Commander from Maryland State Police. And we have Chief Haas, who is in charge of the emergency DES for Queen Anne's County. And without these gentlemen, we truly wouldn't be where we're at right now. And I truly mean that and appreciate you coming out tonight. and sitting through the presentations. I was a little worried because everybody was sitting on that side at first. It's just you guys over here, but it's kind of even out now. Basically, our purpose is to ensure a safe and secure environment for all Queen Anne's County Public Schools students, staff, and visitors, and to ensure the school system is prepared to efficiently respond to all emergencies that might affect the safety or security of students and staff. Basically, we're going to break this down into two parts. One is going to be basically the hardware we have, security cameras, things like that. The other part is going to be dealing with our crisis management plans and some of the items that we put in there. Our objectives are to develop a standardized response to an all-hazards response plan in cooperation with local emergency responders, to assist school administration in emergency crisis planning and building security matters, reduce the risk and improve response to threats and hazards of all sorts. We want to ensure Queen Anne's County Public School is compliant with all MSDE emergency preparedness procedures, and we want an emergency crisis management process. Basically, we're going to look at how we can prevent, how we can prepare, how we can respond, and then how we're going to recover after whatever incident is dealt to us. Where were we 4 years ago? Basically, we had about 5 to 6 cameras at each school. And I can tell you, we weren't really in a good situation. There was 8 different security camera systems throughout 14 schools, so you can imagine that. We had 1 DVR that was located in a technology closet that you needed a special key to get into. There was really no process implemented to identify any cameras that were working or not working. There was no central monitor to view in the front office, and our access controls were very limited. And to just give you one prime example, we had about 70 cameras throughout the schools. We had an incident at Centerville Elementary School where somebody smashed a window, stole a purse, left. I went over there to see if we could come up with anything on the security camera system. I go back in, way in the back to this technology closet. There was 5 cameras. One of them was working. The rest of them have been gone for who knows how long. You know, when we're looking at the technology closet with the DVR in there, Columbine School had tons of cameras, but you had to view the cameras in a location that was basically in the middle of the school. So that's really doing us no favors there. Our access controls, when I went out and started in maintenance, started analyzing and looking at them, some of them would work today. Tomorrow they wouldn't be working. Some of them were hardwired. Some of them were just plugged into an outlet. So when they would go into, say, Queen Anne's County High School is a prime example, the teacher would want to charge her phone up in the faculty lounge. Once she unplugged it, that unplugged the whole system. So you can really see where we were and then where we are today. And we still have, you know, we've made great strides. We still have more strides to make. We were very fortunate. We broke this down into basically a 5-phase project. We were fortunate enough that the fiber optics were installed to all of our schools. And at that time, the security initiative was being instituted by the governor, which gave us more funding to do what we're getting ready to talk about. And then we've also had a great capital improvement plan through the county commissioners where they've been helping us out implementing the 3 first phases. Basically, with the fiber optics, we were able to install a server at each school and one at the central office, so you no longer need the DVR. I mean, it's all on the fiber optics. Second, we looked at, okay, where do we want to concentrate with people coming into the buildings, or do we want to concentrate, you know, in the gym, the cafeteria? What we decided on was, first of all, we wanted to switch up to all digital cameras. Better quality, better picture, better resolution. We had analog cameras. The ones that did work were analog. So we spent weeks and weeks and weeks looking at position of the cameras. So basically, we concentrated on the exterior of the building, then we concentrated on all the main entry points coming into a building so that we could see, you know, hey, who's coming and going with our buildings. We had some vandalism issues at various places. So that was the second phase. The third phase is where we're currently at right now. We were able to secure funding through local government here for our to replace the analog cameras at, let's see, Mattapique Middle School, Ken Island Elementary School, Sellersville Middle School, and we need an additional 11 exterior cameras at Queen Anne's County High School. So that's kind of where we're at right now. To show you where we've gone, we now have 385 cameras throughout the schools. Now, that doesn't deter crime, as you know, law enforcement can tell you, but it has helped us, you know, reach out to find some different issues that are occurring, different allegations that come up. We can go back and look at that video. It's basically operates from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., records nonstop. After 6 p.m., it's on a motion sensor. So we're able to recover that information. We will be starting in about another 2-3 weeks at Sellersville Middle School, replacing all of those cameras that are analog. Then we'll kind of work our way down to Queen Anne's County High School and then down to Mattapique Middle and Ken Island Elementary School that currently have analog cameras. And if you look at the quality of it, it's by far superior with the digital. You can actually see who the person is for the most part. The biggest thing to convey to the principals was this isn't NCIS. You know, we can't zoom into the tag number. I mean, it is what it is. The fourth phase, and we're partially into this phase, we're currently using aging school funds to help supplement additional cameras at some schools. I know like Churchill Elementary School, we were able to put some cameras in the cafeteria, put some cameras in also the gymnasium. The issue with that, you have Parks and Rec and other organizations that use our gyms and cafeterias on the weekend. We'd always on Monday morning roll around, hey, such and such did this and vandalized this. The gyms that we have the cameras in, it has really cut down on being able, you know, vandalism or accidents happening, or he said, she said. It's really helped us out quite a bit. Phase five, when I say the proximity card systems, that's the access controls that allow you to get into the school, buzz you in. We installed iPhones, which is where you go up. The secretary can see you on the camera, buzz you in. We currently have 4 card systems. I would like to try to get that down to 1 system so that we can function more efficiently, because right now I have 1 secretary, Jolene. She handles all the door controls. It's more efficient because what happens, principals, secretaries move around from school to school to school, different system pops up. They're always calling and asking different questions, or this doesn't work. Jolene's very efficient at what she does. And also with 1 system, we would be able to lock down a lot faster than going to 4 different computer programs. All right, where we were 4 years ago with our emergency preparedness plan. We had some flip charts from what I can find. We had multiple pages or paper copies that really didn't have any sequence. We had no national incident management system or incident command system. We had a color-coded system. Basically, if something were to happen in a school, they might say code red, and they were supposed to do this, code green. Well, we did a little tabletop exercise at one of the schools, and I told the principal, hey, let me just add a couple colors. So I broke all the teachers up into different groups and, you know, did code pink, code orange. There was no code pink, no code orange, but they came up with a great plan to do whatever they were going to do. So we went to a standardized system you'll see in a minute. We did not really have a great plan for to train the administrators. I don't think our communication was that well with law enforcement and communicating also with DES. And the Maryland Center for School Safety did not exist. That Maryland Center for School Safety is a pretty unique program I'll talk about in a minute that was created after Sandy Hook. Where we are now, and gentlemen, if you want to jump in, please feel free to jump in. About 6 of us attended the NIMS training. Lieutenant Meal was one of them from Centerville PD up in Emmitsburg at the National Fire Institute. And basically, with the NIMS training and also the ICS structure, whatever school you go to now is going to be would have standardized language. The response is standardized. Who's going to be in charge is standardized. And you have to have multiple layers so that in case somebody is not there that day, the next person knows that they're supposed to step in. we were able to create a emergency site plan that basically has everything in it you want to know about that school, and there's every single picture in here throughout the whole entire school. So if you're going to do a drill, if law enforcement wants to look at it, it's all in here. Also, our emergency shutoffs. A lot of times we would train the principals, and the principals would say, hey, you showed me that back in September. I don't know where the propane shutoff is. Everything has a picture in there associated. When you go in the boiler room, we have tags now that has everything labeled with it. We then broke this down a little bit further. We have an emergency level, top level plan, and this goes to everyone at central office here. And when you flip through this, it's going to give you every scenario from, you know, a person with a gun, reverse evacuation. But also what we found out was, okay, schools have events at nighttime in the evenings. We got PFY, we got daycare. We didn't have any of the contact information in there for those people. In this now, we have contact information for all the site coordinators, for maintenance, for the bus contractors. It's a very handy little booklet that you can flip through to go to. But when you're looking at the school and the classrooms, one of the items that came up was, hey, we have substitutes in here today. They really don't know, you know, what's going on, what are we supposed to do. Teachers, again, would be transferred from one school to another school. So every classroom has a flip chart that it's standardized. It says what the five objects are that we need to train for, and has a little bit more information on there. Now, this isn't going to tell you, hey, you need to go to, you know, to the right door and go out there. But, I mean, it gives you a basic breakdown of, hey, if the emergency occurs, here's what we need to look at. The other piece of information we have is the reunification process. Basically, we have a primary reunification site and a secondary reunification site. So if something were to happen at the building, somehow we have another site that is identified where the students would go. The biggest hurdle we're going to have to overcome is all parents coming to get their children at one time. And that's where it's going to be a communication with law enforcement to help us out so that, you know, we can safely get those students to where they need to go. We went to a training to Maryland Center for School Safety in August, and there was a teacher that spoke about Sandy Hook. And it was very, very moving because she was from Maryland and had just moved up there, dropped their child off that day because one child was sick. And she remembers getting a call and going back. And then all of a sudden, they had this reunification process where everybody went to the firehouse. Well, guess what? The firehouse was locked. Nobody was there. Several of the people that were supposed to be taking the information were deceased. So everything they practiced for kind of went out the door. And it really, I mean, it opened my eyes up to some more things that we need to do better here as a system. And I'll touch base on those things in a little bit. But it really is with the communications that we've developed with law enforcement and DES. Every Monday morning at 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock, we have a call, conference call with the Maryland Center for School Safety, which is based out of the MCAC center over across the bridge. Every school system, for the most part, and public and private, call in along with law enforcement. And they'll go over with us, hey, what are the threat levels for field trips? What's going on, say, with the Baltimore City police officers' trials? You know, what's going on if you have a field trip going to Washington, D.C., and every now and then they have some New York City Police Department individuals on there speaking. We have quarterly meetings with law enforcement, DES, and all the principals at our ANS meetings. And that's really to review our plans, look over the plans, come up with new best practices, but also to review things that we could probably improve on. I know several of the gentlemen behind me were at the bomb threat at Kent Island High School. You know, a lot of things went very, very well that day. You know, we've had experience before, but it's nice when you have the principals in here to share those experiences so that they know, hey, I don't have this in my plan yet, or I need to put this in my plan. We were also very fortunate to have the Maryland Center for School Safety came in here and did an awesome presentation on the ICS structure for each schools. Then they broke down into tabletop with different tables with law enforcement and DES at each table. And they actually, at the time they didn't know it, but they went through a actual scenario that happened, I believe it was Michigan. And there was a lot of talk that developed out of that and a lot of ideas that were shared. You know, some people had ideas on, hey, we should handle it this way, we should handle it, you know, that way. It's going to be something where, you know, the teacher is the first responder. I mean, they're the first one there when something happens. How well are they going to think on their feet? It's our job to give them the tools, the principals the tools, and the teachers the tools to, you know, take care of that. With MSDE, they require 5 drills to be performed each year. One of the areas that we looked at, hey, these drills, we're not really doing them until the end of the school year. They need to be implemented at the beginning of the school year. They need to be practiced. Another great thing that we have is DES and law enforcement are invited to all of our drills that are performed at the schools. So you'll see Chief Haas out there. You'll see Centerville PD. You'll see Sergeant Hampton's been at a few, and also the Maryland State Police have been there. And they'll sit there and basically observe what's going on, come back and have a little, you know, debriefing, critique different situations, and let the principals know, hey, you did a great job here, but you might want to think about this. That, to me, has been very beneficial, having those close ties with them. One of the other areas that we looked at, you have special ed, say Kent Island High School, when they had their bomb threat. Some of the students were sensitive to temperature. You know, you have to look at how can we have access to a primary location to get those students there for air conditioning. Basically, right now, we have access to 3 buses at any time that we can get to a school. I mean, they may be coming from Centerville, they may be coming from Kent Island, but we have that access to pull those buses there to take care of transporting students. Or, again, several of our buses have air conditioning, so getting those students that have some needs on those buses. Communication, I think, is the key to this whole entire process. Building strong relationships with law enforcement, letting law enforcement come in and review the plans. When they come in, you know, to me, they're the experts. They're the ones that have the knowledge about it. You know, our job is to teach kids, but, you know, they also have to understand, hey, here's kind of what we're limited in. Here's the procedures we have. So it's a two-way street, you know, that we work on and get those communication points developed. We also, as I said earlier, law enforcement's invited to all the preparedness drills. One area I think we've improved a lot on is the public information piece. Making sure that when we have an incident that we're talking, and I'm just going to use this as an example, Kent Island bomb threat, making sure the Sheriff's Department and also the school is putting out the same message, because the last thing we want is 2 different things out there. It just causes a lot of problems. We also instituted what we call CODE, which is a central office for a district emergency. When Mr. Paluski says CODE, hey, Ms. Pauls, the executive team, you know, is to report to his office. We now have it set up where he can view the cameras at all the schools on his computer. Basically, we have Brad Engel shows up to where I'm at and is communicating with Mr. Paluski to let him know exactly what's going on and whatever additional resources we need. Communication with the parents and guardians, it's key. I put on there 3 phone calls. Prime example with the bomb threat again, when it happened, Mr. Schreckengast put out, you know, an email message to the parents, you know, we're currently evacuating because of this, boom, 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 short to the point. Second one, hey, how are you going to pick up the students? I mean, because now you have the buses showing up, and we don't want the buses too close to the school, so all of a sudden you have 1,200 kids walking out the door. How are parents going to pick up the kids? Because everybody's coming to the school to pick them up. So all that has to be explained, and then basically a follow-up email or phone call is giving, letting the parents know, you know, what happened that particular day. Yes, ma'am.
Are there predetermined rendezvous places?
Yes.
Parents haven't been informed of that. I haven't been informed.
We don't
tell it ahead of time.
Yeah, it'd come out. I mean, it.
So when it happens, you just say it and then you send out a robocall?
Law enforcement, DES, they know where those are.
Okay.
You know, one thing that we learned about 2 years ago was, hey, have you communicated with your primary or secondary location to make sure that it's still available to use, as in the aging center across from Kent Island High School, a couple different churches? So we have those communications established. Where are we headed? Continue to have training for all administration and staff, continue to develop best practices, keep the communication lines open with law enforcement and emergency services, and to continue with phase 4 and 5 of the plans I talked about. We currently have blackout blinds that we can put across the classroom doors, and we're installing those now. We have them in 2 schools. We still have a few more, you know, 12 more to go. One of the items that I think we really need to pay close attention to is the types of locks that we have in the schools. You know, does every teacher have a key to lock down their door they have? Nothing is standardized when it comes to the locking mechanisms, so it's something we really need to take a close look at. One of the other issues, we need to really get the nurse some supply, extra supplies, and also how can they transport those supplies? So we need to put some funding into that, because you have a lot of students that, you know, take medications, might have, you know, seizures or things like that, that the nurse needs to be able to grab and go. Yes.
On the locks, is it, if I remember correctly, I think it was at CES, is it true that they have to go outside to lock their door and then come back in to pull it?
Some of the schools, yes. You have to lock the door from the outside. We have such a wide range of locks throughout the system. And let me tell you, it is not a cheap a cheap fix. We're looking at other alternatives.
I'm just thinking, like, if there is an intruder in the school, then the teacher has to go out, lock it, and come back in.
And that's,
you don't know where that intruder is.
No. And that's one of the issues. Like I said, we still have a ways to go, because, you know, those type of items are going to take a while to, you know, standardize and implement slowly throughout the school system. One of the other areas, we really need to put in like 2 laptops with wireless connection, because currently right now you'll be doing it by paper. And if you have 500 kids coming out of Centerville Elementary School and you're trying to figure out where they're supposed to go, even with bus accidents, you know, we're relying on paper. So if we can have at least 2 laptops with a wireless connection so that we can look at Power School and say, hey, you know, yes, this is Mrs. Harper's, you know, daughter. You know, yes, this is, you know, she belongs with the grandparents or something. So we really need to head in that direction also. So we do have work to do.
But doesn't all the teachers have laptops?
They do.
Wireless ones?
But what happens is when you go to the relocation site, you're not next to the wireless access points at the school.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
The other thing that we realized was, hey, when Mr. Schreckengoss wanted to send out a message, at one point, you know, we had to go back into the school to send a message out.
You need something with like a hotspot in it.
Exactly.
Okay,
exactly.
That's what I was wondering. Okay, because I was like, well, you have wireless. Okay, got it.
All right. And last slide, I had the contact information for the gentlemen that are sitting behind me. And again, I thank you very much for coming out tonight. I know it's part of your evening. But we really have gotten some very good relationships with law enforcement and DES. I truly want to thank them for all that they do for us. So thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Do you have any questions?
Do they have anything they want to add?
You guys are so talkative.
I'll add a little bit to that. I'm Sergeant Hanson from the Sheriff's Office, and I can go back to about 4 years ago. About 4 years ago, I was actually one of the supervisors in the school resource unit 4 years ago, and I can tell you, back then, we always felt like we were just the Sheriff's Office in the school, but we weren't really together. It was like the school was going to do their educational process, and we were going to do our law enforcement when needed. But now we have this tight-knit
relationship to where our communication's so good. I mean, I really, really think it's come so far, and really, you know, Sid is such an asset to have. When we do these lockdown drills with the schools, when we go in there and we look and we evaluate how prepared they are, it's really amazing how far we've come and really how great of a job they do. And I can say, you know, I have young children, and one of them is in the school system right now. And when we did the lockdown drill at the elementary school that she goes to, and I went in the room and found her hiding, and I said, "What are you doing?" She goes, "I'm hiding. I have to be quiet." I was like, "This is amazing. This is great. You know, this is really what we need, and this is what the community needs to know, is because we're protecting, you know, along with the school officials, their most valuable resource in the county. And that's our future right there. So really, the lines of communication are great. We communicate very well. And when we had the bomb threat at Ken Allen High School, I had guys saying, "Was that a drill?" Because it sounded like it was a drill, the way everything was just falling in place. It's like, no. I mean, you know, with the robocall bomb threats we had last year, you know, it really gave us a lot of experience, and it opened up a lot of people's eyes to say, hey, we really need to talk about this, become more efficient with it. And we've done a really good job, and like Sid said, we've got definitely areas that we're going to keep improving on, but it's a partnership.
We're very, very fortunate to have that. Lieutenant McDonald, I mean, he had, I don't know what, four bomb-sniffing dogs coming from across the state to Ken Allen, you know, High School. And we're also fortunate that they have, you know, the General Assembly with Annapolis Fire Department has a couple bomb dogs. So having those resources there, Centerville PD, I believe it was, what, 2 years ago, did a active trainer, had the FBI come in and do an active shooter training, and basically it's a standardized program. So we had everybody in, you know, Queen Anne's County and surrounding counties come in to take part in that. And I can't say enough about Chief Haas and what he's done to help us out with, you know, the mass trauma bleeding kits that we have installed at every school, basically kind of next to the AED. One of the things they realized at some of these mass shootings was there wasn't enough supplies. You know, people were losing a lot of blood, so we've put those in, and through Chief Haas, it's been a great partnership with that also.
It's unfortunate that occurrences like Sandy Hook have made us be more prepared, but and then in a sense, it's good that we are going to be more prepared. It's unfortunate that that's the way it came through, but thank you all very much.
We do have a principal that was at Perry Hall High School when they had that shooting 3 years ago. He will be coming to our next ANS to speak to all of our principals about some of the things that, you know, went well and some things that didn't go well, and how the national media can be on your doorstep in a matter of minutes. So I think that's going to be a great training for the principal. So anything else?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good job. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, at this time we have the individual action item, the collective bargaining agreement. I do need a motion to approve the collective bargaining agreement for the teachers, ESP, and support.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the collective bargaining agreement with teachers, ESP, and support. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. And at that time, we can move down to sign.
You did the official signing.
Got your blue pen?
I got a blue pen.
Mr. Farley.
Yes. Mr. Pinto.
No, it's just Karen. It's just Karen.
Yeah. Where are they?
Let's see, you
Mark.
Know, certificated one, that's us. Assuming it's at the end.
Mr. Farley, you want to show her where she's supposed to sign?
I believe it.
Okay.
Greg, I think you have to sign. Might as well stay down here because we have to do the other. And this stays with us, Mr. Farley? Does it stay with us?
Yeah.
Okay. Support Unit 1 agreement.
Yeah,
I'm just going to pull them all out. See, by the end, we got it just right.
It's like buying a house.
There we go.
Okay.
Great. Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Next individual action item is the BTE master plan with Miss Julie Alley.
And just a note, just this week, Miss Pauls and Miss Alley and I did a brief presentation to the county commissioners. So it's just a follow-up to you for your approval of that. We want to make sure that they were informed.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
So I hope that all of you have had the opportunity to look over the document. It's essentially been improved and polished since last we saw it. But it's essentially the same information. And last time we went over it, we talked about how it was composed, the first parts being the executive summary, which kind of has the information about Queen Anne's County, the budget narrative, a synopsis of our goals and progress seen through the lens of how we're doing with our special education students who receive special education services, our EL limited English proficiency, and our students failing to make progress or achievement, and then the assessments that we have listed. And then section two again is more of an expansion on that, where they give you more detailed information. And again, the following part is a complete listing of all of the assessments that we have and why we have them. So at this time, if you guys have any questions, I'd be really happy to answer them.
I didn't have any.
So we just make a motion to accept this? Is that what we're doing? Oh, that's awesome.
So do you want to make the motion?
Make the motion to accept. What are we calling it?
The BTE master plan.
The BTE master plan.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the approval of, call for the vote to approve the BTE master plan. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you, Ms. Alley.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Ms. Alley.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda is the final contract for Solar City.
Solar City Solid School. Is that him?
That's Solar City.
I didn't know if that was your guy or not.
No.
Oh, I don't know.
I have with me tonight Mr. Brent Eske from Solar City.
Welcome.
In case you have any technical questions or any of those items. Last year, we had presented to you the possibility of installing solar between Centerville Middle School and Queen Anne's County High School.
Just to give you a quick breakdown and some background information on this, several years ago, the county government, town of Centerville, and the Board of Education went through an RFQ and an RFP. We narrowed it down to three companies. We interviewed those three companies, and we had selected Solar City. Since then, Solar City has did a ground mount at Graysonville Elementary School that's been very successful. They have a out-to-safety drive. They have a huge array out there. They also have one at the sanitation department on Kent Island. So they're established, company. They're very successful in what they do, and they have a great product that they're delivering. Currently, if you're looking at the up there, it's about 5 acres. And we're looking at putting in about a 2.7 megawatts of electric on that space there. Currently, there's soybeans on there. We get a very minimal amount of money donated, charged, given to the FFA. With that being said, we would able to divert the electricity, as you can see, to Centerville Middle School to the right. Great location for the where the transformers are and power. Also, same thing at Queen Anne's County High School. Another aspect of this is we were able to secure a grant from the Maryland Energy Administration where we can install basically a humongous battery that is going to store the energy. And when peak demands come, we're able to use that energy to store it in the battery and provide that to the schools to lower down our peak. We would be the first system in the state of Maryland to put that in place, so that would be quite an accomplishment. So basically, that's the layout of it. And what I wanted to show, I thought I had it up here, but I guess I didn't, is, here we go. I know that's kind of hard to read, and I apologize for that. What we're looking at is a 20-year agreement, a power purchase agreement with Solar City. And one of the unique features that we did not have at Graysonville is there is no escalation clause in this. We will be paying a flat 6.5 cents per kilowatt for the next 20 years at Queen Anne's County High School and Centerville Middle School. So we'll know what the number is, ahead of time. We can plan for that. We did have the slight change that I did want to tell you about. We did have 5.5 cents, but we had to jump it up a cent because Delmarva Power was requiring a lot of infrastructure upgrades, about $150,000. We don't have $150,000 of capital laying around. We were able to work with Solar City to get that moved up for them to take care of that through that 1 cent. Basically, in the first year, we're looking to save about $202,000. Over 20 years, you're looking at basically $5.5 million. The two items that I'm asking for you to approve tonight, one is the power purchase agreement, which basically it says for the 20 years, here's what you'll pay. There is, if we want to terminate the contract, we can terminate the contract. It will show you, how much that is. The other important document is there is a performance guarantee. So if they're not performing as far as the electrical, the solar panels, and we're not meeting what they stated we would get, they end up paying us back money for that.
Is that guaranteed or is that just a...
Yes, it is. So it's we call it our, so I think Sid said, our performance guarantee. And so we'll actually give you in the contract a kilowatt hours we will generate each year. If we don't generate that amount, we'll refund you what's the set amount in the contract, but basically the difference between what you're paying now and what we're selling you power for. So the spread now is probably 4 cents. So let's say we came up 30,000 kilowatt hours short at the end of the year, we would refund you that 30,000 kilowatt hours at that 4 cent rate.
So the 6 cents stays the entire 20 years?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. For a $150,000 investment?
Well, no, so you actually have
$150,000 of increased upgrades that Del Marbury asked for.
Right, so we were at a 5.5 cent rate, and I'll get a little more detail on that. Sure. So we actually had, you know, these projects go back a few years, and as you know, there's a lot of big solar happening in the county, right? And so initially when we cited these, we got actually to an interconnection process and talked to Del Marbury, and I said, guess what? The lines are maxed out. You can't put any more solar on here. So 3 years later, the Y Mills project's completed, the county projects are completed, they had done some upgrades to the infrastructure there. They said, hey, we think you can fit this over at the schools now if you're interested in looking at it again. We said, sure. So we went ahead and went through the process of doing another interconnection application, and they came back, and we had, you know, erred on a side of caution, provided $150,000 of interconnection in our budget, and actually ended up being $275,000. So that increase has to come from somewhere. You know, the other challenge we have now is when these contracts were signed, or when we were talking about this project a few years ago, the incentives were different. Now we've got SRECs that are renewable energy credits that are diving, and the incentives are tougher. So it was surprising to me that we were able to pull off for a penny increase, but still staying 3 or 4 cents below, you know, your rate now, and fixing that for 20 years, I think, is a pretty amazing scenario for you all.
Okay.
Yeah, to give you an idea, new projects we're pricing at this current time are close to 8 cents, so almost 2.5 cents higher, just due to some, you know, things that are happening in the industry and things happening in the state.
And there's no way to, after 10 years, maybe renegotiate so we could get back to the 5.5, or is it just going to, we sign this deal and it's 20 years and that's it?
That's right. Yeah.
The only other hurdle we have in front of us, and I don't really foresee it being a problem, is there is in the regulations for the town of Centerville, this is in the town of Centerville where we're going to locate it, they don't have anything in their plans for a ground mount system. So we are currently going through that, and I believe the 17th or 18th of October, we should get that final clearance to go ahead with that.
Would there be an increased cost with that?
No.
Okay.
No, it just, they didn't have it in
the permits necessary through planning and zoning. That's all done by them.
They take care of that.
And that's included in the cost.
Yep.
When we did Graysonville, they took care of all of that information mm-hmm. and requests, but I don't really see it being a problem with the town of Centerville. I mean, they have one at their irrigation distribution center, but it's outside of town, and, you know, so I don't see it being a hurdle that we can't.
It's a crazy question, but since that will no longer be farmland, is it going to be in a different tax structure with county taxes?
No.
Okay. Just
that's a good question.
Well, I'm just wondering, since now it have a building per se on it, it'd be taxed differently.
And all of our documents that we have been reviewed by Darren Burns, who is our legal counsel that does all of our contracts for us. He has approved all of the power purchase agreement and the guarantee agreement also. It's been in contact with Solar City to make sure that the two align. So he has given his blessing on this also.
Will the solar arrays be a part of our capital projects, or will they, I don't see it in here, who owns the equipment? They do.
Yeah.
Okay.
And at the end of 20 years, we can keep on doing what we're doing, or we can purchase it for the fair market value of
okay.
it.
Okay, I saw that at the bottom, so I was wondering who owns it during this process.
So, I mean, they have the incentive to make sure that, hey, the grass is cut, you know, things aren't growing up around blocking it off, you know. The pitch sometimes comes up about snow on it. Basically, with the incline it has on there and the heat gets to it, it slides right off of there for the most part. I did ask that question in North Carolina High School, so.
And there are actually two systems at that one site. I know it looks like one, but one was feeding the middle school directly. That's a behind-the-meter connection. That one is still at the same rate, the 5.5 cents. It was an easy interconnection. It was the larger system, which actually we're doing what's called aggregate net energy metering, which will allow us to actually offset the power at any number of schools. So Sid will be able to go through and look at maybe where your higher cost is at different schools and target those accounts first, and maybe even increase the savings that way by looking at, you know, where your highest cost meters are. But we can do an unlimited amount of meters on that system up to the generation, which will be about 3 million kilowatt hours. So we haven't gotten into much detail on those, selecting those particular accounts, but that's another opportunity we have to sort of increase the savings as well.
Because the other big cost consumption would be Kent Island High School. I mean, we really don't have the room there to put a ground mount system in there. So
with this one, if there is the extra capacity, we could use that towards purchasing electric there at Kent Island High School. So, any other questions or?
Just that, are we leasing that to a farmer for soybean? Just curious.
We do, and from the best information I can gather, it's a small amount of money that we get. It's non-irrigated land. It's not, you know, the prime farmland. There's actually, for the solar part, it'll work out great because there's actually a little inclined hill there that we can get a little bit more out of. I think the amount of money you're going to save far outweighs that, you know, cost of money that's given. So.
And I'll also add the timing of the initial discussion, really end of last year when we started really narrowing down these contracts, was really ideal timing from a cost standpoint. Now, if we go back 3 years, when the county had signed their first project, it was one of the first large projects in Maryland. I think they were at 7.25 cents with a 2% escalator over time. So over the next 3 or 4 years, we saw the prices drive down, and you guys really got in a good time getting a flat rate that's probably a penny and a half below your supply rate, but will also offset the supply and the distribution charges.
And the extra costs.
And the extra costs. Right.
Any other questions? Okay, so Sid, you need a motion to approve the power purchase agreement and the performance guarantee?
Yes, ma'am. That's correct.
Okay. So can I get a motion?
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the power purchase agreement and performance guarantee for Solar City. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll see you soon.
All right, see you. Thank you.
That light is blinding. Sid, can you shut?
I got one more.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Right of entry. It's Sid's night.
It's Sid's night. Yeah.
Okay, hold on.
Right of entry.
The right of entry at Queens County High School.
Basically, this has been a over a year process. The Maryland Transportation Authority contacted me and said, hey, we have some issues with the railroad tracks that go behind Queen Anne's County High School. If you look up top there, you can see the football stadium, and behind that is basically just an open field that really tilts down towards the railroad tracks, and also basically there's a stream behind that, the railroad tracks. Water was running off of the field there and was causing the tracks to become unstable, and eventually we have about 150, 200 feet that it's washed out totally underneath of it. Now, my question to the Maryland Transportation Authority is, I've never seen a train go back there.
It's been a while.
Which is
they
true.
Used to. Yeah. They used to. I remember them.
And the train stops, its last stop is at Tidewater Publishing. But by law, any tracks that are still out there that the MTA owns, they still have to maintain those tracks. So really nobody knew about this, and how it came about was the river keepers were down there doing some water quality samples and stumbled across some high levels of sediment coming down. Contacted us, contacted MTA, went out there, took a look at it. Yep, it was washed out pretty good. Now those tracks have to be repaired, and it's kind of a two-step process. We were able to secure funding through grants to do a wetlands project behind the school there and stormwater management, and actually include the ecology classes and the science teachers, so that they're basically having a living classroom, because we were responsible for taking care of the erosion problem. We were not and are not responsible for taking care of the tracks or the area washed out. The Maryland Transportation Authority came out, EPA, several other agencies from the state. We all sat down and met. And what I kind of want to point out is they need a right of entry. There's two documents. One's a right of entry. It just states, yes, you can go back there and perform the work. The other one is a basically an easement or standard option contract.
Both of these documents have been reviewed by Darren Burns, our attorney, and also the Maryland Attorney General, because they had a couple items in there, the MTA did, that did not, they didn't realize that, you know, some of the laws were different for the school system. So we were able to actually profit in this a little bit, and I'll share with you that in a minute. Basically, the MTA is looking for a right-of-way to go along the paved road, past the tennis courts, back to the wrestling building. And then they're looking to have access to go along the woods and get back there to where the work really needs to be done. We had the appraisers come out by MTA, and they feel that the fair market value to being able to have access to that is $21,600. And they would be responsible for maintaining to get back there. If you're asking, hey, are we ever going to build on anything back there, a lot of it is wetlands. A lot of it is close to the stream back there. I really don't forever see us building anything in that area back there. So our attorney and also the Attorney General think that it's a fair deal. Like I said, they would pay us $21,600 to have access to get back there to fix that. And part of it benefits them because, hey, if they have to truck everything in by train, you're looking at a heavy price to fix the problem that's back there. So,
disruptive is this going to be to the students?
None.
Okay. None. Trucks going back there.
I've sat down with them and gave them the times that, hey, the trucks that they're transporting anything in need to be in by this time frame, and they need to be, they can come in after the students leave if you're hauling anything. The great part about this, I should say, is we were, when working with the students and the teachers, we were able to save most of the soil when we were doing the wetlands back there. So they're not going to be trucking in a lot. We were able to keep the cost down and use the dirt and fill dirt and all that is back there. They will have to truck in some rock and some things like that. But they're responsible for fixing anything that, you know, develops because of that. They will be responsible for that also.
And the EPA will be on top of them with...
Oh, yeah. They were... They were all out there. It was a big powwow. So
okay.
So I'm just looking for to give them permission and right away, and we would be paid at $21,600 for that.
Is this to the state, you said?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Maryland Transportation Authority.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I need a motion to allow. Is this a right of entry or an easement for ingress and egress?
Sorry, I had a mint in my mouth. That's okay. It's a, the first part is a right of entry.
Okay.
All right. And then the second part that needs to be approved is the easement.
Okay. So I need a motion to approve the right of entry and the easement to the Maryland State Department of Transportation.
So moved.
A motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the right of entry and easement agreement with the Maryland Department of Transportation. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you, Sid.
Thanks.
I forgot about that. Okay, that was at the end anyway, so we're good. Thank you. Next is a transportation report, and we need to approve the substitute drivers, which I will pull up so I can get it correct. Okay, we need a motion to approve substitute bus drivers for 2016-17 school year, Martha Dawkins, Sue Green, David Parks, and James Thomas.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the substitute bus drivers for 2016-2017 school year, Martha Dawkins, Sue Green, David Parks, and James Thomas. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. All right. Next is the calendar amendment. Mr. Farley.
Get to the, there we go. Is this the amendment or the calendar committee?
This is the calendar amendment.
So the...
I would actually ask that you join me if you wouldn't mind, Mr. Brown, and I have been teaming up to work on the calendar matters. The amendment is to modify the calendar to include half days for middle schools in addition to elementary schools for 4 days, which were originally reflected on the calendar as half days for elementary. And I'm not certain where that document is on here. Let's thank you, Jackie. Thank you. Appreciate your patience with me. This is my first time at this table.
Already been pressing the plus key.
Zoom in?
The plus key. No, the plus key right here.
Is that big enough for folks?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You can see here in the red where this particular calendar, which is our current calendar year, has been modified to add middle schools for the half-day schedule. And the rationale is that we had an administrative oversight in our calendar development this current year. We meant to add middle schools but didn't. Without adding middle schools to this, we wouldn't have sufficient transportation, especially on the north end of the county, to get students transported appropriately. So we ask that you accept this amendment so that we can get the modified calendar out on the web.
My question is the half day reporting to parents. With middle schoolers, teachers have 120 some students. How are they going to get their parent teachers time in a half a day?
Well, there was no parent-teacher conference, to my knowledge, in the calendar right this year at all. So we have heard from parents that wanted some opportunity to confer with their teachers, and this provides that. While it may be challenging from a volume perspective, it's certainly better than it was.
Right. I mean, one of our key goals is improving communication, with especially with parents. And I just don't see a half a day in the middle schools is yeah, elementary school, though, they have 25 students all year long, but middle school teams, and they usually meet as a team, you know, you could have well over 100.
I guess traditionally they never have had it. I mean, I went to middle school, I asked for it, and they will have it for students that are in trouble, so they do the whole team, and I had no problem getting. Even if I asked for it, I wasn't asked to do it, but I wanted to do it because I was used to it in elementary.
Right.
And then I didn't need it after that. But
traditionally, here we've always had
it's been optional for parents. Yeah.
At least Mattapique it's optional.
So I mean, I don't know. I just feel that, especially with sixth grade, you know, first year in middle school, I just feel like half a day is not sufficient.
And then that's one of the things that we looked at. And when we spoke with, and Ms. Pauls, I know, has met with middle school principals specifically on this. One of the things that we realized, because it was not in the calendar, is that schools have been having parent conferences already. that they have already been scheduling. So we did take a look at it just to look at the sixth grade and what that impact would be. That might be a little logistic of a challenge. I know that when we spoke with the middle school principals, many of them have been conferencing either virtually or through any kind of multiple mode of communication other than face-to-face. But we recognize that certainly in sixth grade is a major transition year.
Right, that's a
and year. Parents want to, you know, have a face-to-face or comfortable with that from a middle school perspective.
We also made the eighth, we made that optional. We asked the principals to structure the day so that teachers would have the option to leave the PD to meet with parents if that was necessary. And they were willing to do that.
Did they also offer them a fourth, since there's a half day as well? I see it's got PD on it, but was that also offered as an option?
It is an option as well, too, if they have everything ready. But it is an option, yes.
Could it be considered that sixth grade goes one extra day as well as, what is it, ninth grade?
Right.
More than anyone. What if on just November 7th, you have sixth grade do conferences all day and seventh and eighth do half day? I mean, they wouldn't be losing a day. The teachers would already be there.
We didn't know how much of an issue that would be for parents on such short notice that they would have all of their...
Probably not much more of an issue than putting in half days that weren't there before, correct?
Well, their elementary kids would be going home anyway. But now, I mean, they'll be the only ones in middle school that won't be there. And that's what we're afraid it might create an issue with such short notice. I mean, it's less than a month away.
Kids aren't going to mind. They're going to have an extra half day.
Kids will never mind. we didn't want to inconvenience families.
I get that.
That's something we can certainly further take a look at. Even though approving this on the half day, we could.
But as then we'd have to amend the calendar again.
Have your parents been complaining about that?
Well, no, I just know that my son was sixth grader last year, and they were booked, sixth grade teachers, back to back, you know, so.
We did only have there were a few parents that did request having at least a half day. I know that myself and Ms. Pauls and Mr. Farley did receive some feedback from parents requesting a parent conference on that half day. But that was only one, so. Mm-hmm.
And it's optional, so.
It is.
Right.
It is.
Yeah. And look at how long spring break is now.
Mm-hmm. One thing I could recommend is maybe making the communication a little better that it is available if you want to do it, because I specifically called them and said, where's my conference, you know, it's for sixth grade parent. And then I learned, oh, did you want one? We only do it for students that are having trouble. I said, yeah, I want one, and we got them.
Right.
So maybe, well, I didn't know, and you probably didn't know ahead of time to be able to schedule that, too. So maybe we just need to communicate that better.
Right. My only thing is, though, is, I mean, what if we do get a lot of, I mean, is that going to fall on the teacher's professional time, on their after school? Like, I mean, I think that's, we have to look out for them as well.
Certainly, a parent can request a parent conference at any time.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And I know that many do. So.
Okay, I'm just throwing that out there. I just
sure.
feel like.
Do you think we need to plan that for the next calendar, as a calendar committee person? Do we need to plan that?
It's actually an interesting idea because of the
calendar.
Transition in ninth grade and sixth grade of maybe building it in for the, as we are looking at potentially a post-Labor Day calendar.
Maybe for the next calendar.
Which has a little bit of. Shorter time in different areas. Spring break.
We need a motion to accept the calendar amendment. Is that what we're doing right now? And we just say calendar amendment?
Yeah, I guess that's what we need, a motion to amend the calendar.
Do we also want to do that last day? Do you also want to include that last day, right?
I beg your pardon?
Given the negotiated
Agreement is signed now, you want to include the last... omitting the last day.
Yes.
Another amendment.
Okay. So we would include that in which the last day for teachers and students would be June 14th.
Right.
Pending weather, the winter.
Mm-hmm. Snow days.
Nice snow days.
Okay. So I need a motion to approve the calendar as amended, the calendar amendment as presented, and also amending the last day for teachers or staff, to 10-month staff, I guess.
To June 14th.
Yeah, to June 14th.
So moved.
I have a motion, I have a second.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to amend the calendar as presented, as well as amending the last day of school for staff to June 14th. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it. Next is the calendar committee update.
So Mr. Brown and I will be presenting to you this evening on the activities of the calendar committee, provide you with an overview of the calendar development process, discuss some of the statutory and professional day constraints on the process, the pre and post Labor Day start as recently ordered by the governor of the state of Maryland, and discuss the virtual calendar development. So we are proud to say that we began this process in a timely manner for everyone's benefit, that we included parents, teachers, support staff, building principals, content supervisors, and our Board of Education member, Captain Kelly, and thank you. One of the issues that really drove us was that this recent executive order required that we start after Labor Day and finish by the 15th of June, which, as we are seeing now, is a quite a bit of pressure. There are certainly arguments on both sides of this issue with regard to its benefit to our community and pressures that it puts on our educational process. We are able to apply for waivers. However, recent amendments to the governor's executive order make that a much more difficult and challenging process. We know that we wanted to work collaboratively to optimize student learning as much as possible, the fiscal benefits, and to present you, hopefully, with a calendar that would be vetted through community input by approximately November, and we brainstormed on ideas that we could use to move forward. We know that the Comar has certain statutory holidays we have to take off. That hasn't changed. We discussed the waiver some. Mr. Brown loaded in the prescribed testing days. We had to look at end of semester days for transition and grade loading. Parent conferences, Maryland State Education Association conference, professional development days, and we have a goal of projecting this calendar out for 2 years rather than one, so that we can allow parents and administrators to better plan going forward. So with that said, I'd like to ask Mr. Brown to talk with you, and I'm sorry, I probably went on a little more than I should have.
Not a problem.
You should have on board docs four calendars, two of which are for the 17-18 school year, two for the 18-19 school year. There is a pre-Labor Day start. It's not on board docs.
Mm-mm.
Not on here. And actually, I'm having trouble picking up what was just up there.
Hmm.
Is something up?
I have that, but I don't have any calendars.
No, neither.
Can you act it out, Dave?
No, but I can pull it up on a flash drive.
Oh, good job. Something you want to need it? Are you got it?
Yep.
Okay. Sure. Do you want to switch spots?
That's why he's the man.
He is the man.
Right now. All right.
Flash drive comes up. Not my flash drive.
Do we need to swap out the drives that are there?
Not sure whose flash drive that is.
I think it's John Lishner's.
Let's see if yeah, move it up to the top one. We'll see.
There you go, sir.
Well, we're waiting to see if that can find it. At least start talking about the calendar. We did originally plan for a pre and a post Labor Day start for each of next year and the following year. However, in light of yesterday's second executive order from the governor, there's probably not a whole lot of sense talking about the pre-Labor Day starts at this point. As Mr. Farley said, we did have to consider several things. Legal holidays. COMAR requires us to have Labor Day off, Thanksgiving Day, and the following Friday. From December 25th through January 1st, Martin Luther King Day, Good Friday, and the Monday after Easter, and Memorial Day are all legal holidays in which we're required to be closed. We also considered the MSEA conference and figured that would be also a good time to be closed so that we're not worrying about substitutes to provide coverage for teachers that want to attend the conference. As Mr. Farley said, we did want to maximize teaching time and as much classroom time before state assessments as possible. We also want a sufficient number of whole PD days and half days to allow for professional development and to provide time for parent conferences. And in the calendars for both years, we do have a fall middle school conference that is a half day and a full day conference, just like the elementary schools. So we did take that into consideration in the calendars. It never did came up. So I got a flash drive that's not going to pull anything anyway.
Can't force it. Do you want to put on a music video or something?
You know, I should have printed paper copies.
So we will put the calendar out on board docs for your feedback. In addition, the calendar committee will be meeting at least one additional time to finish allocating the days and finalize discussions and ultimately to make a recommendation that we would put out on the website and get feedback from our community members. We want to do all that promptly because we're coming up into November and we need to wrap it up in order to keep it moving for everyone's benefit.
Briefly, the calendars have five new teacher days as prior to the start of school, as well as five professional development days prior to the start of school. There are four professional development days per level within the calendar. And we have all statutory holidays. The school is closed, as well as MSEA Convention Day. And we did include the Thursday prior to Thanksgiving, since many parents have asked for that in the past years as a travel day. It does include six half days for elementary and middle schools.
Thursday prior to Thanksgiving?
I'm sorry, the Wednesday prior to Thanksgiving. six half days for elementary and middle schools. Five half days for the high school are included in there. And four of those half days at the high school are for the final exams for first and second semester. It does figure 185 school days for students, which includes the five built-in snow days, which we can redeem or get back at the end of the year if we don't use them. The first day of school in the post-Labor Day calendar would be September 5th, which again is the Tuesday after Labor Day, per the governor's executive order. The last day of school would be June 14th. Scroll down there, maybe I just a little smaller. So the first week, the light shades of green, beginning August 14th through the 18th would be new teachers. The 21st through the 25th would be professional days. The green September 1st day should... That is completely wrong.
That's the pre-Labor Day.
That's the pre-Labor Day. Thank you.
I was going to say, Labor Day's not until September.
There we go. That's the one, what it should look like there. The post-Labor Day start, the 21st through the 25th is the new teachers. The 28th through September 1st would be the professional development days of teachers returning. September 4th is Labor Day. And then October 2nd would be the first of the professional development days. That would be for all schools. October 18th is a half day at the high schools. That is for PSATs. It's half day all schools. But high schools, that would be PSATs. And then half day for the professional development. The 20th is the MSEA convention. Jumping down to November, we have a half day, November 3rd, for elementary and middle schools. That would be for conference preparation, end of the quarter, calculations at the middle school and conference preparations. The 9th and the 10th would then be conference days at the elementary and middle schools. The 10th would only be for the middle and elementary schools. High school would be in session that day. It would be a regular school day for the high schools. The 22nd through the 24th of November would be our Thanksgiving break. And then in December, you see the 25th through the 29th for winter break. And if we scroll down, we will pick up January 1st, the end of the winter break. The 15th is Martin Luther King's birthday, and then we come up to the end of the semester at the high schools. The 24th and 25th would be half days for the high schools for final exams. The 26th and the 27th of January, both high schools would be off both days. Middle schools would also be closed on the 29th for professional development. Elementary would have school both of those days. February 19th, all schools would be closed for President's Day. I did leave that one off as a legal holiday. Forgot to mention President's Day. March 16th would be a half-day professional development for elementary and middle schools. Again, that would be time to calculate that we're talking about the end of a trimester coming up there. The 30th of March through April 2nd would be the spring break. That is minimum is allowed by law. And then our 12th, 13th, and 16th of April would then be parent conferences for elementary schools. And the middle schools would be closed those half days as well. But not the full day. Full day would be a school day for middle school and high school.
On the 16th.
On the 16th, yes. The 25th of May is Memorial Day. And then the 13th and 14th of June would be half days for the high school for final exams. And the 15th would be a last day for teachers. The 14th being the last day for students. There's a lot of green dots on there, but they are not system-wide PD. In order to get conferences in and still allow for professional development in places, some of the conferences or some of the PD days are for all schools and some are just for high school or elementary middle.
Is that working in our five snow days as well?
That includes 5 snow days. So if we would not get any snow and get those days back, the last day for students would be June 7th.
Wow.
Of course, if we use 10 days, the last day of school could be the 21st.
But we're also, look at what we've cut back at you know,
there's not a lot of
winter holiday.
There's not a lot of blue on that calendar.
The winter holiday and the spring break is cut
as I
back.
Said, that is as required by law, with the exception of November 22nd, which is the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. All those other blue days are what Comar.
And that's a lot of school time in February and March with hardly any break. Mm-hmm. That's a lot.
Well, March is all testing mostly.
All
too.
Testing.
But again, this is what it needs to be. We have one day to spare before the governor's deadline. This is the governor's calendar, starting the day after Labor Day and being done by June 15th. So we could add one more day in there, and that's it. That does meet the, includes 9 professional development days for each teacher. They're not all the same days, but each teacher would have
9. It should be 10. We haven't done a contract for next year.
We haven't done, okay.
That's right. That's correct.
And what we would do with that is one of those days it's just elementary, and one of those days it's just high school, we would make both elementary and high school, and we would pick up the 10th day there for professional development.
Just a question, I mean, Jennifer's concern, maybe we need to talk to the administrators and see if there's a need for somehow putting in these conferences for 6th grade. I know it's hard for 6th grade because you got 7 teachers sitting around a table, so scheduling that is a real bear, I'm sure. But I don't know if there is a need. We need to look at it. I mean, the amount of time that we've got in this calendar matches the amount of time we have for elementary conferences. Or is it less?
It includes a fall conference for middle school, but not a spring conference for middle school.
Right. And the elementary has that.
And the elementary has a spring and a fall.
So when they have that, is the middle school off?
Middle school would be in session during the full day of conferences, but they would have the half day off for the half day of conference.
And we might want to look at that. Maybe they need to be off if there is a need, and that would be something worth checking because. Yeah.
But we're not.
No, it's just an overview of where the committee is at the moment of understanding the parameters around the law, as well as the work that they've been working on with a pre and post.
And could I make the recommendation that we're only going in this direction and not looking at a pre-Labor Day start? I mean,
I don't think we have an option.
I mean, he's being very adamant about. I don't want them wasting any time on it.
No, that's right.
I mean, the only people that get waivers, he's made it pretty
very clear.
Small box.
And he's made it very, very hard to get a waiver.
Yes.
So
we will put the 17, 18, and 18, 19 calendars on board docs and proceed in our committee to work and resolve any final issues before we move forward in soliciting feedback.
Just a step ahead here, be careful because he actually made this rule at a very opportune time because of when Labor Day starts. But you'll see later on, a couple years from now, Labor Day starts almost a week later based on timing. And the Christmas ends up like in the middle of the week. And it really is a difficult situation that parents are not going to be happy with. We're going to have to just go 25. We're not going to be able to give them the 24th off, and they're not going to like that. So the future is going to be worse than this.
And that is one of the things that I know that you've been working on within the calendar committee is to try to present to the board 2 years out. So that's one of the things that we're not sharing is we've got 17, 18, but you're also working on 18, 19 just to show what some of the ramifications for the – so when – we come in November with a recommendation. It'll be for 2 calendars.
That's right.
2 years out.
And the 18-19 calendar is almost identical to this. It's basically just starting one day, actually one day earlier, because Labor Day falls on the 3rd next year. The only difference is there's an extra day at Christmas because it's not worth coming to school on the 24th, I think is where it would fall on.
Monday.
Right, it's not worth coming to school on the 24th for one day. So it does add an extra day to Christmas, to winter break.
Yes.
Leeway there.
Oh, yeah.
I just want to thank...
You get a lot of sick calls.
I want to thank Mr. Brown, who I believe is going to help us create a virtual calendar that you can say, I want to see these kind of days, I want to see those kind of days. Ms. Geneva Harris, who helped us do all the beautiful work, and the members of the committee, because there's no shortage of emotional attachment to calendar.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brown.
Thank you, gentlemen.
I keep running over your lunch.
See on your side.
I'm getting blinded. All right, next is the third and final read of three policies, the curriculum expense for students, negotiation regulations, and the military policy.
I'd like to make a recommendation that we table the military policy just for another month, because we need to get a little more information on this. Make it a part of the motion. Has anyone had any other kind of feedback, Mr. Farley, on any of these policies?
I think there was a wide array of feedback, Ms. Harper, is that some people felt it wasn't appropriate, given that we hadn't paid one of the steps in the history of our collective bargaining. Some people felt it should be given to firefighters and police officers. Some people were grateful and felt it was very appropriate. Those are sort of the three themes that come out of the emails that were received. And obviously, our goal is to treat folks fairly within our budget.
Okay, so I have a motion on the table to table the military third and final read.
So moved.
For the purposes of gathering more information, right?
Yes, please.
Okay.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to table the military experience third and final read to gather more information. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, the curriculum expense for students. Do you want anything you need to add to that, Mr. Farley?
I don't believe that we've received any other further comments on the rest of those two policies.
What about negotiation regulations?
No comments.
Okay, so then I need a motion. Are we putting it out? No, we've already put it out for the final read, right? We're just approving it now. Okay, so I need a motion to approve the curriculum expense for students and negotiation regulations.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept to approve the curriculum expense for students and negotiation regulations. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Next is the HR report. We need a motion to approve the HR report as presented to us in closed session.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the approval of the HR report as presented in closed session. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we have to approve there's two field trips. Sellersville Middle School, 6th grade, to North Bay Adventure Camp, and the Queen Anne's County High School Symphonic Concert and Marching Band to Music in the Park.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion?
I do have one question.
Mm-hmm.
In the past, we've had like Mattapique Middle and Stevensville Middle went to North Bay at the same time in the spring. Sellersville and Centerville
in the fall.
had gone together. But we're sticking them in North Bay in early December. I mean,
it's because Sellersville Middle School children cannot afford to go in the spring. the price goes
there's a
triple.
Price difference.
It's more than triple.
It's like off-season, on-season, so to speak.
Mm. Yep.
And that's a shame.
It is.
That is.
It's not equitable.
Try to get grants and
it's not equitable.
No, but it's a shame that North Bay does that to school systems, you know.
It's a higher rate.
That they charge a higher rate. That's just a shame.
Well, at least they're doing it in December this year and not February.
What? Yeah.
They've been snowed out every year. They lose 2 days every year.
Mm.
So this will be the, if usually by December it doesn't snow. And
it's usually
the weather early. Could be a little bit better this year for them, but they always lose 2 days out of their four because
well,
of that.
We need to look at this because this is a big equity issue.
Mm-hmm.
For
agreed.
All the yes. sixth graders can do this, and just because one school can't afford it, they...
Yeah, it is a shame.
You know, we need to look into that, what we can okay. do sure. to maybe work on that for next year and have them go back to going at the same time as
makes sense.
Yeah, same time as Centerville.
The right, because there's a lot more they can do when the weather is more.
And it's good, you know, it gets them together. They're going to end up in high school together. I mean, in many ways, I think it's advantageous.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good point.
Okay, so I need a motion to approve those two trips.
We had a motion.
I'm sorry. We just I have a second. That. And we had a... Okay, any questions or comments regarding it? Not hearing none, I call for the vote to approve the Sellersville Middle School 6th grade to North Bay Adventure Camp and the Queen Anne's County High School to Symphonic Concert and Marching Band to Music in the Park. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it.
That's a great time at Hershey Park, too.
Yeah.
Can I ask... Can Paige leave?
Yes.
Sure, Paige. Have a good evening.
You're meant sitting to say that quiet. About a half an hour
yeah,
ago.
You're so quiet. We forget about you sitting there.
All right, babe.
you just have to ask, that's all.
Thank you.
See ya.
This is your first rodeo. You've been here over a year. You ought to know, yeah, well, speak up. Come on.
I'll just leave now.
Okay.
Take care.
See ya.
Okay, as the agenda was modified or amended, we need to approve the collective bargaining teams as were presented to us. So I need a motion to approve those teams.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the approval of the collective bargaining teams. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, next is the future action items. Looks like there's a second read for the gangs, gang activity, and similar destruction of illegal group behavior, media material selection guidelines, and cell phone policy.
And I believe that the only one that received multiple public comment would be the cell phone policy.
Mm. Okay.
So I believe there were 17 or 18 responses, if I remember that correctly, when we reviewed those, Mr. Farley.
Yes.
We're also reviewing that instructionally with the principals as well to review that policy mm-hmm. as it is written and receiving that feedback to make justification. So at the third read, we will make a recommendation on language if we need to, and then we'll present that to you for final read and discussion.
Do you want us to table it now to give you more time, or do you think there's enough time to the next meeting? I'm only asking them because they're the one that's, you know.
Well, we could always table it on the third.
Okay.
Just put it out on the second.
Okay.
Yeah.
So be in
and
November.
If we have issues, then we could table it then until we discuss. So we need a motion to put those three policies out for a second read.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion, a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to put the three following policies out for the second read. Gangs, gang activity, and similar destruction or illegal group behavior, media material selection, and the cell phone policy. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Next are our reports, starting with the superintendent report.
Just two very quick things that I want to draw attention to. Last week was a very busy week, but to highlight two very positive things that I know many of you were involved in. Number one, that is Unity Day. That was such an outstanding connection between the community and our schools to represent diversity as well as anti-bullying. Was very, very successful. And I also want to commend Mr. Engel and the entire anti-bullying committee that put that together. Second is the outstanding event that we had last Friday in Baltimore. which would have been the Maryland State Teacher of the Year Gala. Recognize Ms. Tamara Forte, unfortunately, did not win that, but she is certainly number one in our book, and that was certainly a representation of Queen Anne's County Public Schools and the great work that goes on every single day. That's it.
Great, thank you. Next is the curriculum and instruction report.
Just wondered if any of the three of you went to Unity Day, because we were unable to go.
We had doctor's appointments. We weren't.
And so I'm just wondering. Yeah. It's really worth going for
I've been
you
to it
to
last
see.
Year.
I went last
it's
year.
It's really, okay.
I was part of it.
Because we ended up going, which we talked about last meeting, I went to Sellersville, and because they had a couple of events on Monday and Tuesday, which enabled us to participate, even though we weren't going to be around because we were at the MABE conference. So, right. And it was really, really good at Sellersville and Mattapeak Elementary. Oh, and we also went to Baseline, so we went to four of the events they had on those 2 days. So it's important that we continue that too, that Unity Day. And I just want to make sure it doesn't die off, because there was a lot of, it takes a lot of work to get it done.
This is our sixth year, I think it was.
But I think it's really worthwhile for the kids, really is. I mean, it's, I understand it takes a lot of work, and I'm not sure how much we're going to embrace it to continue. Hopefully, we will continue to embrace it.
And our elementary was on Channel 11. They had a flyover from Channel 11, so that was nice. Very nice.
Great.
Okay, next is the curriculum and instruction report. Ms. Pauls?
The CNI team have been very busy. All supervisors have attended a state briefing and shared those updates with the appropriate team members. Supervisors have all been in schools conducting formal and informal visitations, and I personally have had the opportunity to visit all of the Centerville schools. Tomorrow I'll be headed to the island. And all curriculum supervisors also, along with the specialists, had the opportunity to participate in 2 days of deep curriculum professional development, and Mr. Page, our science supervisor, has already begun the work with aligning his curriculum according to that training.
And just to add that training was in response to the curriculum management audit, the deep curriculum. So we had all of our supervisors, all of our teacher specialists, math specialists, teacher specialists, reading specialists. It was a great professional development day.
Okay, next is the expenditure report. Ms. Landgraf.
Okay, well, I gave you a new report this time. Actually, you have two new reports. The first one is really a very summarized, I'm going to say 30,000-foot view. Basically, it just lists all the 12 different categories that we're responsible for reporting our expenditures in. Gives you the budget, gives you the...
It was on there, though.
It's on board docs.
We're on board with, but now it's gone on board docs. But I saw it earlier because I wanted to thank you for the one report you kind of spelled out how it was broken down.
Yes.
And it was so much easier to understand once you read that.
Yes.
And then going to look at the numbers.
Yes. So essentially, that's what I did. I gave you kind of
I like that a lot. I really appreciate that.
Just so that you could understand what you're looking at.
Right. It helped tremendously for me.
Okay. Well, this is the type of report that I would like to give you from this point forward. The one is very summarized. The second one gives you a little more detail, basically breaks down each of the categories into the six areas that they need to be reported in, salaries, contracted, services, and whatnot. But basically, when you go to the right side of the report, it tells you what the available balance is. It tells you what percentage of the budget has been spent at this point during the course of the year. So I think it kind of really can give you some real quick information about where we are in spending.
Right.
The three areas that I already have not necessarily a concern about, but I know that we're going to need to transfer some money to these areas. Administration, contracted services, legal fees. Believe it or not, because of the bus contractor arbitration and whatnot that we've gone through, we have spent our budget already this year on legal fees. So we're going to need to transfer money to that category. Special education, non-public placements.
We had two very large placements over $100,000 apiece this year, so we're going to need to transfer money to that. I'm still waiting on one call sheet for a student that is in placement, and so that I can get a final number on what we're going to need to transfer there. And then, of course, transportation, contracted services for the bus contracts. We just got the final numbers in the end of September to do all those calculations as to where we're going to be, and that's probably going to be about a $285,000 number. What I'm currently waiting on is we just signed the contracts tonight. I can now put those salaries in so that I can get some figures and figure out where we're going to cover these things, to see what kind of attrition we have, what that number is going to look like. So that's kind of where I am.
Do we not know about the non-placement?
Pardon me?
Do we not know about the non-placement of these students when we did the budget back in January, February? Because I don't remember hearing that there was going to be a problem.
No, we didn't know about one of them. Okay. One of them just moved into the county that had a over $100,000 tuition.
Okay.
And I think the other one was one that had been placed mid-year last year. So when we looked at the numbers, they didn't look that bad because it was only a half-year placement.
Okay.
So
now we're talking about a full year. Yes.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Excuse me.
Next on the agenda is the second citizen participation public comment, if anybody else would like to speak. Okay. And upcoming events and meeting and events. I don't really have anything listed. We have a work session on the 19th.
We do. I just want to double check because Friday is the Hispanic Heritage Day evening event at Sudlersville Middle School. I know we didn't list that, Ms. Jackie, but I wanted to make the board aware of it.
What's the time on that?
6 p.m. 6
to 8. 6 to 8 at Sudlersville Middle School,
yes.
Correct?
And the work session on the 19th
is from 9 to 12.
9 to 12.
Yes.
And when we publicize that, we have to make sure that, because we keep posting, we keep putting on there, it's like 11 to 2, but it is a 9 to 12 meeting.
It is 9 to 12. We'll make sure that we post that on our, I'm sorry?
I'm sorry?
You've already sent a press release for
the
9 to 12
time. Okay, good. Thank you. Okay, and at this time, I need a motion to close open session.
So moved.
I have a motion. I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to close open session. All in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it. Good night. Thank you for attending.